Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Jack Garrett, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Life and Times of Winston Churchill. Your professor is John Ramsden. Professor Ramsden was educated at Oxford University and has taught at Queen Mary University of London since 1972. He is currently Professor of Modern History and Director of the Humanities and Social Sciences Graduate School, and was formerly Head of History and Dean of the Faculty of Arts. Professor Ramsden's main line of research to date has been on the 20th century history of the British Conservative Party, in which he gained an Oxford Doctor of Philosophy in 1974. He has written all three 20th century volumes of the Longman History of the Conservative Party, and published with HarperCollins in 1998, An Appetite for Power, a single-volume history of the Conservatives since 1832. Dr. Ramsden was general editor of the Oxford Companion to 20th Century British Politics, and co-author with Professor Glyn Williams of Ruling Britannia, a textbook history of Britain since 1688. He published in 2002 The Dam Busters, a book on the British film of 1955, and Man of the Century, a book on the post-war image and reputation of Winston Churchill. Professor Ramsden currently serves on the academic board of the Churchill Center, based in Washington, D.C. The son of a British father and an American mother, Winston Churchill, even in his birth, brought together those two countries whose shared language and history would help them found one of the most important alliances of the 20th century. Churchill, who served in the army, worked profitably as a writer, enjoyed painting, and was an amateur bricklayer, had from his earliest years an industry and zeal that propelled him to the position of Prime Minister of the British government, an office he first held from 1940 to 1945, and then reclaimed in 1951 until his resignation in 1955. It was as Prime Minister during the war years that Churchill showed himself to greatest advantage, firmly assuring British resolve in the face of German aggression, while maintaining, with Franklin Roosevelt, a partnership between the United States and Great Britain that would overcome the Axis powers and determine the course of the post-war world. As Roosevelt became identified with the American war effort, so did Churchill with the British struggle. His exhortations to the public and determination in the midst of the great crises of the day, the retreat from Dunkirk, the Battle of Britain, marked him as not only a leader of the machineries of government, but as a representative also of the spirit of British honor and courage. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin Life and Times of Winston Churchill. Lecture 1, Family, Background, and Identity. And now, Professor Ramsden.
Winston Churchill was called the giant of the century. He was voted the greatest Briton. Many people believe he was the man of the 21st century. But he was an improbable hero for what was often called the century of the common man. Not only because he was personally so very uncommon, but because he was from an elite British family and was never closely in touch with ordinary people in Britain, let alone the rest of the world. In this course, we're going to look at what made Winston Churchill such an extraordinary person. We're going to review his early life and the heritage that brought him to such prominence. An American biography of the 1940s called him Mr. England. What is it that made Winston Churchill quintessentially English in this special way. In this course, we're going to look at Churchill's career as it fanned out across the late 19th and early 20th centuries. In the first two lectures, we're going to review Churchill's early life, the heritage of English history that he was later seen to encapsulate in his personality, in his very being. An American biographer of Winston Churchill in 1941 called him Mr. England. We're going to ask ourselves, what was it in Churchill's early life that helped him to become such a quintessentially English figure? We're going to review the army life that made Churchill a specialist in military affairs, the wars he went to as a young man, and the way in which he learned so superbly to manipulate and use the English language, the way he learnt to send it into battle as one of the weapons of war. In the next three lectures, we're going to analyse Churchill's political success as a young statesman, and some failures and his need to fight back from failure too. We're going to see for the first time the resilience in which Churchill was able to react to despair when his career seemed to be in ruins in 1915, a fiasco in the middle of the First World War for which Churchill was asked to shoulder much of the blame. And we're going to find that Churchill had to fight from that point on in his career the perception that he lacked balance and lacked judgment. After that, we have three lectures on the course which will analyse the finest hour of Winston Churchill. Churchill the writer, a promotion of political ideas and of Churchill himself, but at the same time devoted to campaigns of crucial political importance. These were the years in which Churchill campaigned against the appeasement of Adolf Hitler and called for the rearmament of Britain to prepare for the Second World War. But these were also the years that culminate in the speeches that rang around the world as radio broadcasts in 1940, the inspiration for the free world in its battle against totalitarianism. Lectures 9 to 11 are on the Second World War. Here we see Churchill dealing with the dictator Joseph Stalin and having to adjust his sights to the Soviet Union as an ally, though Churchill himself was a lifelong anti-communist. We are going to analyse the way in which Churchill coexisted as a much more successful partner with Franklin Roosevelt and the democratic United States. A friendship of partners, an agreement between friends, an extraordinarily close political and military alliance. But it was an alliance that terminated in 1945 with the big three, Stalin, Roosevelt and Churchill, unable to prevent the slide into the triumph and tragedy of 1945, the Cold War, and indeed Winston Churchill's own ejection from office at the end of his greatest military and political triumphs. Lectures 12 and 13 show Churchill practicing his motto of never giving in. Never, never give in, he told the schoolboys of his old school Harrow during a visit in the war years. And we see Churchill therefore coming back from the crushing defeat of the 1945 general election. Moving on, though, to other triumphs, his Fulton speech in Missouri in 1946, a series of other oratorical triumphs that helps to make him Prime Minister again in 1951. And we see Churchill writing the history of his own lifetime, but the history of the epoch in which he had moved, the story of the Second World War. And in the final lecture, we're going to understand better the way in which Churchill, the man of the century, was viewed at the time of his death, reviewed in the years that followed, and assessed at the end of the 20th century. This was the life of an extraordinary man, a man of wit, humour, extraordinary resource and resilience, a man of personality and energy, whose motto, never give in, was carried through into action through a public life of more than 60 years. And when you have completed this course, I think that you will conclude, as I have done, that Winston Churchill was the man of the 20th century. In the remainder of this first lecture, we're going to find that the Churchills were a family with an extraordinary history which Winston Churchill inherited. We're going to analyse the parental influence and indeed the parental neglect that helped to shape Winston Churchill, the personality. And we're going to try and understand Churchill's character with which he embarked on such an extraordinary and outstanding public life. So, to begin with, who were the Churchills? Well, the Churchills were a rather typical British aristocratic family. They had most of their fame from a very short period of political prominence in the 17th and early 18th centuries. There was a Winston Churchill who fought for the king during the English Civil War, a country gentleman from the county of Dorset in southwest England, where there is a place called Churchill. This man was knighted later, and he founded the family effectively. Much later, the Winston Churchill we're looking at in this series was said to be quintessentially English. He was seen to represent around the world a special quality of Englishness. And it was his ancestry, his background, his heritage in three centuries of English history that counted for a great deal in making that his identity. Now, the son of the first Winston Churchill, the first prominent Winston Churchill, rose to become a very important man indeed. He rose to be the first Duke of Marlborough. John Churchill was an extremely astute politician, probably England's greatest general and certainly one of the great generals of Europe. He fought in the army. He deserted the Catholic King James II in 1688 and helped to bring about the Constitutional Revolution of 1688, which enshrined parliamentary government as the core of the British Constitution. At the beginning of the 18th century, in the reign of Queen Anne, he was effectively the Prime Minister, though the title didn't yet exist. But he was also at the same time the general who commanded the British army. He fought a long campaign against the French and won four great battles, many sieges, many skirmishes, a great captain in the history of warfare. The first Duke of Marlborough's campaigns ended the French aspirations to dominate Western Europe. Well, of course, the British people were so grateful. Queen Anne raised Marlborough to the status of a duke. Parliament voted him a huge sum of money on which to retire, and then they also gave him money to build Blenheim Palace in Oxfordshire. This became the family seat of the Churchills, one of the few British families who were not royalty to live in a palace. It's still there in Oxfordshire, in the family's hands, though it's been open to the public, and certainly to be seen by anyone who visits England. One of England's greatest stately homes, designed by one of England's greatest ever architects, Sir John Vanbrugh. Well, the Winston Churchill we're going to study on this course was actually born at Blenheim Palace. He was brought up to know all about his great ancestor. All his life, he loved history. He loved war and soldiering. They were part of his inheritance. After the first Duke of Marlborough, though, the family was not particularly prominent. For the next 150 years, it's only fair to say, the heads of the family were not particularly talented either. But they were always there as part of the British public scene. The Duke sat in the House of Lords. The Duke was the leader of society in the county of Oxfordshire. And sometimes they managed to aspire to second-rank political jobs when their party, the Conservatives, were in office. The seventh Duke of Marlborough, Winston Churchill's grandfather, was, for example, Lord Lieutenant of Ireland in the 1880s, and the young Winston Churchill actually spent a good deal of his early childhood in Dublin, being brought up in his grandfather's house. But Winston's own father, Randolph Churchill, was a very different thing. He was called Lord Randolph Churchill as a courtesy. As the younger son, he couldn't expect to inherit the title or the money that came with it, unless his elder brother were to die without any children. For a time, this seemed quite possible. His elder brother didn't marry until quite late. And for a short time, after his father died, young Winston Churchill himself was heir to the Dukedom of Marlborough and might have ended up in the House of Lords and so never been able to become Prime Minister. But it was far more likely, as it actually happened, that Lord Randolph and his son Winston would have to make their own name and their own fortune by their personal efforts. Lord Randolph was a Conservative MP by the time he was in his mid-20s, and he was soon seen as a rising man. He had a caustic wit, a readiness to be rude to everyone, including his own side, and he was as much feared by his own party's leaders as he was by the Liberals on the other side of the House of Commons. Many commentators, many politicians, regarded him as a reckless political gambler, interested only in his own career and making a name for himself. But he had enormous charm, great intelligence, huge force of personality, a great speaking skill, and the ability to inspire confidence in some people, even when he was arousing doubts in many others. Lord Randolph's success in politics was quite short. In the Parliament of 1881 to 1885, he helped to destroy the career of a weak conservative leader called Northcote. But this mainly helped his rival, not himself, the more politically astute Marquess of Salisbury. Salisbury went on to be Prime Minister for 14 years. Lord Randolph Churchill was in the cabinet for only one. He came to the top for a very short time as Chancellor of the Exchequer in 1886. He then had a big row with his cabinet colleagues, foolishly resigned over an issue where none of them would support him, and was never invited back into government again. He was already a man in some physical decline. A life of heavy drinking, gambling, and general dissipation was catching up with him. He became steadily more moody and difficult for the last 9 years of his life. These were the years in which Winston Churchill was a teenager. His father died in 1895, aged only 45, seen as a comet of a politician who had rocketed to the top and fallen back with equal force. He'd probably died from a brain tumour, though for long it was thought that he died of syphilis, the consequence of the life that he'd led. Well, like many aristocrats of that generation in Britain with no money, Lord Randolph married an American heiress. In his case, it was Jenny Jerome, a beautiful woman by all accounts, and the daughter of a man, Leonard Jerome, who had made many fortunes in the robber baron period of American history. She didn't bring Lord Randolph much real wealth. He never really had much wealth, even with his heiress. It was certainly a love match, though. And their eldest son, Winston, was born prematurely less than 8 months after they were married, in November 1874. Victorian parents, living in the busy social world of public and political life, like Randolph and Jenny Churchill, did not expect to bring up their own children. Winston, as a young boy, had little contact with his father, and the small amount of contact that he did have was mainly negative. There are stories of the young Winston coming down cheerfully to breakfast, banging around the crockery and the cutlery and being ordered out of the room by Lord Randolph with his hangover. Even before his illness, Lord Randolph had little time for children. But Jenny Churchill was equally remote. For the young Winston, as he says later in his autobiography, My Early Life, his mother was like a remote fairy princess that he'd worshipped from afar. All the same, when Lord Randolph had died young in 1895, and his widow Jenny then embarrassed her adult son with affairs and with a marriage with a much younger man, he continued always to worship his father and to adore his mother. Deprived of direct parental affection, Winston was effectively offered the love an affection that he so craved by his nurse, Mrs. Everest, although Winston always called her womany. Winston clearly loved Mrs. Everest dearly. He was absolutely devastated when she died. He was in his late teens at the time. And along with his younger brother, he paid for a handsome grave memorial to be erected to the memory of Mrs. Everest. When he went to his first school and was treated with great cruelty by the head teacher there, who beat him, it was Mrs. Everest who rescued him from the cruelty. When he went to his senior school and asked that his family should come and see him perform on open days, it was not his parents who went to those public occasions, it was Mrs. Everest. In almost every real way, Mrs. Everest was his mother. And perhaps it's really important that at that crucial formative stage, Winston Churchill was brought in touch with an ordinary person from a non-elite background who introduced him to what non-aristocratic people, poor people, were like, what their experience was. As the son of a great public figure, it was inevitable that Winston Churchill would go to one of Britain's major schools. It was almost inevitable he'd go to the same school as his father, Harrow School. Harrow was one of the two most elite schools in Britain. Many conservative politicians with whom Churchill interacted in his later public life were old Harrovians. And in cabinet in the 1920s, he sat under a Prime Minister, Stanley Baldwin, who was an old Harrovian, and with four or five colleagues in the cabinet with him who'd been at the same school, some of them at the same time that he had been there. Winston Churchill was brought up among those who were destined to rule the British Empire. Churchill was not, though, a very good schoolboy. He was a pretty rebellious and unsatisfactory schoolboy, though perhaps he made a little more of this in later life than was quite the truth. There are stories, for example, of him fighting back when treated so cruelly at his first school. He tells the story in his autobiography of a straw hat on the back of the door. And when the headmaster had beaten him, he creeps down in the dead of night and stamps on the hat as an act of retaliation against this adult who is making his life so miserable. As a boy, and indeed as a man, Winston Churchill was quite short in stature. As a boy, and to an extent also as a man, he had a speech impediment, and this at school made him the subject of ridicule from many of the other boys. Churchill developed a robust way of fighting back, sometimes physically. There are stories, for example, of throwing a future cabinet minister into the fountain at Harrow when they were schoolboys together. He could, though, commit himself to things that really interested him. He was an adventurous boy, and as a fencer, he won the English Public Schools Championship. He could also show application to his studies when the subject really interested him. And it's significant that the two subjects at which he did well at Harrow School were history and English, the two subjects at which he would excel for the rest of his life. History as a writer, English as a user of the language. Now, how did all this make Winston Churchill what he was? Who was Winston Churchill? Parental influence was clearly important here, even though it was mainly a negative one. We shouldn't make too much of the fact that Winston Churchill was neglected by his parents, because the experience he had was fairly common for boys and girls of his class and time. But we do know that it had a profound effect on him. He adored those parents who starved him of love, and this was clearly a critical factor in driving him on through his career. All his life, he wanted to impress his parents. When he became Chancellor of the Exchequer in 1924, 50 years old, he reflected that now he had reached the same office that his father had reached, and indeed, he could wear the same ceremonial robes that his father had bought in 1886 and that had lain neglected, or as Churchill said, slumbering in their tin box since Lord Randolph so disastrously resigned. And in the late 1940s, after his great triumphs in the Second World War, he wrote a short story, a story he never published, but which was found in his papers after he died, a story called The Dream. In The Dream, the elderly Winston Churchill slumbers over a painting, and in his dream, his father comes back and talks to him about his career. He imagines his father finally approving of him. At that period in his life, when he was a great world hero, he still wanted his father to say, "Well done." Now, the real Lord Randolph Churchill as a role model had both positive and negative effects. From his father, perhaps Winston Churchill learned to be self-indulgent, both in politics and in personal appetites. The love of alcohol that Lord Randolph perhaps died from was also there in his son. Some of the depressions that Lord Randolph suffered from in later life would be found in the older Winston Churchill too. Like his father, Winston Churchill could be egotistical in the extreme. He seemed to care only about himself and what he was doing. He could take his family for granted. He could shout at his staff. And he could treat most people around him as if they were there to serve his needs. But like his father too, he had immense personality and charisma. And in one sense, and perhaps a fascinating sense, he may have even overcompensated for his father. His own children were never starved of love or of indulgence. Yet along with that British father, whose name, Churchill, was written in the most glorious passages of British history, Winston Churchill had an American mother. A mother whose own family background was more mixed and more cosmopolitan. It may indeed have contained vestiges of Native American blood. Winston Churchill certainly thought so, though it's been hard to prove for historians since. We do know that Winston Churchill felt immediately at home when he visited the United States in his early 20s. He made quickly many American friends like Bernard Baruch, who remained friends of his for the rest of his life. He was, as he frequently said, an English-speaking union in my own person. This was going to be a factor of enormous importance for Churchill's career, especially in and after the Second World War. Winston Churchill was proud of quoting an interview that the great German statesman, Bismarck, the creator of modern Germany, had given to the New York Times. Bismarck had said, "The most important political fact of the 20th century would be that the English and the Americans spoke the same language." Winston Churchill was the embodiment of that English-speaking union because of his English and American parentage. But above all, Winston Churchill emerged by the mid-1890s as a man driven into himself, onto his own resources, by parents who had neglected him, by schools that didn't appreciate him, perhaps, and he'd become very tough indeed psychologically. He had been driven towards achievement and in due course towards leadership. This could, of course, have been a very bad thing, had it made him impervious to the needs of others, as he sometimes was towards those of nearest around him. But Churchill also remembered from his school days the consequences of neglect, and he retained in adult life a remarkable softer side. He was always very emotional, a rare example of a public man ready to cry in public when he was moved. When in 1940 he visited bombed British cities, the sight of Winston Churchill literally weeping amongst the ruins of the bombing conveyed to those people who saw him, directly or in newsreels, the sense of his personal involvement in what the war had done to ordinary people. He felt for people, as well as wishing to lead them. It's a remarkable combination in a politician, the tough and the tender existing side by side, and it's an essential part of Churchill's personality. But above all, the Churchill that had emerged by the 1890s was a man who already had self-belief to a quite remarkable extent. As a historian, this is so useful to us. He was already filing all his letters. He knew that historians would want to know about Winston Churchill in the future. He kept practically everything. We can know more about the life of the young Winston Churchill than we can for most other politicians, because he knew we'd need his papers. In his letters to his mother, a regular correspondence in the 1890s, he was frequently talking about what he was going to do, what he was going to achieve, his great hopes, his belief that one day he would become the national leader. And frequently he added to this the statement, "I can only say all this because I believe in myself." You know, I believe in Winston Churchill. On one occasion, he put it much more poetically. He'd already learned just how to use words to clothe a thought with a little more depth of meaning. "All men are worms," he said, "but I do believe that I am a glowworm." That little phrase captures Winston Churchill's ability to communicate, but it also captures where he'd come from as a schoolboy, where he was ready to go next as his career began. This is what this course is going to be about, is tracing Winston Churchill, the glowworm, through a career as a soldier, a writer, a politician, a war leader, and a prophet of international relations.
After listening to Lecture 1, a student posed this question to Professor Ramsden. Why didn't Lord Randolph Churchill sit in the House of Lords? Let's listen to the professor's response.
Until 1999, all the holders of actual titles, hereditary titles, sat in the House of Lords. But in the case of a major title like a duke, their sons were called either by a junior title or simply Lord Randolph Churchill in this case. But that didn't give them a seat in the House of Lords. It was simply a courtesy to reflect the fact that they were the sons of a duke in this case. And so although Lord Randolph Churchill was called a lord, he actually sat in the House of Commons because he was technically a commoner. Only his father, the Duke of Marlborough, was a peer of the realm and a member of the House of Lords.
Life and Times of Winston Churchill, Lecture 2, Soldier and War Correspondent.
Winston Churchill wrote in his war memoirs of the Second World War, of the moment when he became Prime Minister in 1940, "I felt as if I was walking with destiny, and that the whole of my life had been a preparation for this hour." Well, we saw in the first lecture of this course how far Churchill's childhood had prepared a personality for leadership. And Britain and all in the West who looked to him for leadership in the battle against fascism in the Second World War were fortunate that among those preparations were personal experience as a soldier and a formidable way with words. Two things that came together in the finest hour of Winston Churchill in 1940, but which can be traced right back to the late 1890s when he was a soldier and a war correspondent. And it is Churchill's life as a soldier and a war correspondent that this lecture will be about. We'll look at how his personal war experience affected his later life directing the strategy of great powers, how he learned to use words effectively in his early writing, and how far his soldiering was really always the prelude to a career in politics. We shall review the way in which Winston Churchill became a soldier, his life in the army, and the way it contributed to his future career. We shall analyse the extraordinary fact that Churchill went out of his way to find wars, to take part in them, and to see what the fighting was really like. And we shall see how, in 1900, Winston Churchill becomes a worldwide celebrity, coming out of the Boer War as a genuine war hero. So to begin with, how did Churchill become a soldier? With hindsight, it seems almost inevitable that Winston Churchill should have been a soldier. But he tells us in his autobiography, My Early Life, that it was almost accidental. It followed on from a rare conversation with his father. He says he only had 5 real talks in his life with his father, but on one of them, Lord Randolph Churchill visited Winston in his nursery and found him playing with his soldiers on the floor. He watched Winston directing his army of soldiers, and eventually Lord Randolph asked him if he'd like to join the army himself. It's pretty likely that Lord Randolph didn't see the army as a great career. It was traditionally the way that you employed the younger sons or the stupid sons of the family. The older ones went into politics or the church. The younger and the more stupid ones went into the army. Those who were unfit for anything else became soldiers. But in choosing to offer Winston a military career, which he accepted, and sending him to the military college at Sandhurst in 1893, Lord Randolph fixed Winston Churchill's future for him. As we've seen in the last lecture, Churchill's earlier educational experience had been fairly unsuccessful. It wasn't quite as bad as he later claimed. He liked to claim, of course, like many great men, that he made himself. He didn't quite so much as he claimed. He was quite good at English and history, as we've seen. At one of the public days of the school, indeed, he was chosen to recite a lengthy extract from Macaulay's Lays of Ancient Rome and held the school spellbound as he orated the story of how Horatius held the bridge. Here was Winston Churchill discovering the way to perform words as well as to write them. Knowledge of English literature and a fascination with history were perhaps ideal qualifications for his future career as a political leader, but they were not ideal subjects to qualify him for entry to military college. The Royal Military College at Sandhurst, in Surrey, just outside London, was the one route that young men had to take if they were going to become officers in the British Army. So Winston Churchill just had to pass his exams to get into Sandhurst if he was to have a career as an officer. He failed the first two attempts to get into Sandhurst, and at the third attempt he just scraped in. It was an undistinguished way to start a career in the army. And it's often been said that Winston Churchill's life as a teenager is one from which many young people at school and university can draw comfort and hope. He made success out of a very poor beginning. But once he was at the military college at Sandhurst, Churchill thoroughly enjoyed himself. He passed out very well, having entered among the last of the group. But he still didn't satisfy his father. All was a hard taskmaster. Churchill therefore joined a cavalry regiment, but he wasn't able to join one of the best regiments of the British Army. He began to learn the real arts of soldiering after college and in the real army. Strategy, tactics, riding, and handling men in action. He was a very good rider, an adventurous soldier. He wasn't universally liked by fellow officers. He was thought to hold forth too often about his own views on every subject in the mess in the evening, and never to want to listen to the views of others. Well, this was perhaps a feature of Winston Churchill all his life, but more developed in his early days. In part, he was probably talking too much because he felt rather vulnerable among men who were better educated than he was himself. He was very active in horsemanship and especially keen at the sport of polo. The regimental team won the Army's national polo competition when Winston Churchill was in the team. And he went on playing polo for as long as he could in his adult life. Later in life, he hunted, rode to hounds until well into his late middle age. But Army life, once he'd got used to it, bored him thoroughly. Long periods of inaction, and this was especially so when he was sent to India with his regiment in 1896. Denied even the chance of action on the part of India, the northwest frontier near modern Afghanistan, where there was fighting with the tribesmen, he was sent instead to garrison duty in peaceful southern India, where there was nothing to do but train, groom the horses, drink and gamble. Churchill decided characteristically to use this period of enforced idleness by undertaking a crash course in reading. He got a list of prescribed books from friends at home, got hold of the books by post or from the local libraries, and hurled himself into a course of reading history, political thought, philosophy and the classics. It was self-education by reading, very often in the long afternoons and evenings, and combined with what was already an extraordinarily retentive memory. This meant that he never again felt any educational inferiority to those who'd been to university, which he had not. That memory and that reading served him so well in later years when he could quote at will from poetry, from philosophy, and from the classics. It also provided him, though, with the vocabulary and the syntax, the way of organizing words, and the style of a good writer. Perhaps more than anybody, he learnt from Edward Gibbon and Lord Macaulay, the two classic historians of the 18th and 19th centuries in Britain. Churchill learned from them both a way of expressing himself in long, rolling sentences. But he also learnt and practiced in his later life that history was not just a subject for academic historians in universities. It was a matter of public debate. What had happened in the past influenced the present and the future. When Churchill became a historian, he wanted to be a historian like Gibbon, who would be discussed, who would influence events, who could combine history with a career in politics. Well, an unexpected spin-off of that ability to use words effectively was an early move towards a political career. His first actual political speech was to a Conservative Party rally in Bath in the west of England in 1897. He was on leave from the army at the time and just drawn in to address this political rally. But this was not his first public speech. For 3 years earlier, in his last term at Sandhurst, he had been drawn into the most remarkable demonstration in central London. The London County Council, worried about the morals of the young men attending the Empire Theatre in Leicester Square, where the bars of the theatre adjoined a promenade much favoured by the ladies of the town, had decided to erect barriers between the theatre and the square itself. Churchill and his fellow cadets at Sandhurst were incensed by this interference with the freedom of the public to walk around central London. Churchill wrote to a newspaper appealing to the rights of freeborn Englishmen to walk around their capital city, stressing the constitutional arguments of freedom and liberty. And when this didn't work, he led a team of Sandhurst cadets and eventually, with a crowd of 200 people or more, stormed the barricades, leapt on a table and addressed the throng with the cry of freedom. It was a wonderful example of the youthful exuberance of this cadet from Sandhurst, just ready to embark on his career. Another spin-off, and much more surprisingly, was that he wrote a novel called Savrola, published in 1899. Perfectly respectable first novel, but sold rather well in both Britain and the United States. But there's no doubting that the central character of this thriller about a political revolution in a central European country is Winston Churchill himself. All novelists are said to write their novels, their first novels anyway, from autobiography. And Churchill certainly did. It's an ideal picture of the young Churchill as a political leader. But to an extent, although he wrote no more novels.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.